The Adventures of Sherlock Holmes. The original and immortal stories of Sir Arthur Conan Doyle, dramatized anew, with Sir Ralph Richardson as Dr. Watson and Sir John Gielgud in the role of Sherlock Holmes.
I think I remember the six Napoleons, mainly because it was such a triumph for my friend Sherlock Holmes. The one time when his old rival Lestrade of Scotland Yard unashamedly spoke his praise. It hadn't always been like that, of course. In the early days, Lestrade had more than once been inclined to jeer at my friend's original methods. But by the time of this particular adventure, he'd lost some of his old enmity. He'd taken to looking in on us in the evening at Baker Street and talking about old times and generally keeping Holmes up to date in everything that was going on at police headquarters. But this particular evening, as Holmes improvised on his violin, Lestrade fell curiously silent and puffed thoughtfully at his cigar for a moment or two.
Lestrade? Anything remarkable on hand?
Oh, no. Nothing in particular, you know, Mr. Holmes.
Oh, just so. Then hadn't you better tell me all about it?
Well, I suppose there's no use denying it. Except that it's such a peculiar business, and I'd hardly wanted to bother you with it, Mr. Holmes. In fact, it's really more in the doctor's line than ours, I suppose.
Oh, really? What, some illness of some kind?
Mental illness. Madness at the very least. And a queer kind of madness at that.
Really?
Now, you wouldn't think there was anyone living in this day and age who must hate old Napoleon so much that he smashes to bits any image of him he can lay hands on.
A hatred of Napoleon? Well, that's a very curious obsession, sir.
Yes. Hardly in my line, by the sound of it. Watson, I defer to you.
Thank you.
Yes, but the only thing is, of course...
Well, what, Lestrade? You're still chewing, you know.
Well, this maniac fellow adds a bit of burglary, too, do you see?
Burglary,
so as he can get hold of these images he wants to smash.
Really? Just pass the tobacco, would you, my dear fellow?
Yes, of course.
Thank you.
It must be Napoleon, I take it, Lestrade.
Well, it seems so, Doctor. First case came in 4 days ago. Shop of a man called Morse Hudson, who sells pictures and statuettes and such in the Kennington Road. The assistant was in the back shop, and he heard a sudden smash, and when he rushed through, somebody had thrown down a plaster bust of Napoleon and broken it to smithereens.
Oh, valuable?
No, worth a few shillings maybe, not much more.
Oh.
Anyway, the shop fellow ran out to the street, but there wasn't any trace of anybody by that time.
But something's happened since, obviously.
Yes. Last night. There's a well-known doctor called Barnicott, who lives only about a couple of hundred yards from Miss Morse Hudson's shop.
Yes, yes, I've heard of him. One of the biggest practices south of the Thames, they say.
Yeah. He's a bit of a collector, too, isn't he? Antiques and so forth.
Huh?
Same man, gentlemen. Well, he'd got hold of a couple of plaster casts of the famous head of Napoleon by some French sculptor or other called Devine. He put one of them in the hall of his private house and the other in his surgery at Lower Brixton. And when he came down this morning, Doctor...
Huh?
House burgled. And yet there wasn't a thing taken but the bust from the hall.
Good gracious.
And believe it or not, it had been carried outside and smashed against the garden wall, same as the other one in the shop.
Ah, this is certainly very novel, Lestrade.
I thought it would please you, Mr. Holmes. And it isn't the end yet either.
The other bust, in the surgery.
Exactly the same, Doctor. Smashed to smithereens in the place where it stood. Dr. Barnicott discovered it the minute he opened the door. And that's the whole story, Mr. Holmes, as far as it goes.
Oh, well, it's curious, certainly. Now, Watson, come, pray give us your diagnosis.
There are no limits, my dear Holmes, to the possibilities of monomania. A man who'd read deeply about Napoleon, for example. Or a man who'd received some hereditary family injury through the Peninsular War, for instance. I mean, a man like that very well might conceive some kind of obsession.
Come, my dear Watson. Well, considering how many examples of Napoleon's busts there must be, no amount of monomania would explain why such a promiscuous iconoclast should chance to begin on three examples by the same sculptor.
Huh?
As I take it, Lestrade, these three are all copies of the same original and all bought at this man Hudson's shop.
Every one, Mr. Holmes. Identical. Uh-huh.
Why, then, the fellow may have an obsession against the sculptor.
Possibly. Yet even if it is madness, there's still method in it. You see, he carefully takes the bust that was in the house outside to smash it because a noise might have wakened the people upstairs. But in the other case, he smashes the bust in the surgery just where it stands.
Oh, really, Pooh-Pooh, that's too trifling, my dear Holmes.
Oh, one never knows, Watson. One can never be quite sure. Some of my most classic cases have had the least promising beginning.
Yes, but
you'll remember how that dreadful business of the Abernethy family was first brought to my notice by the depth to which the parsley had sunk into the butter on a very hot day.
But, Mr.
Holmes, surely we can't.
Parsley strayed another cigar, my dear fellow, and ring for some whiskey and soda. I have a notion that we may hear more of our friend of the statue.
And we did, of course, or there would be no story to tell. Next morning, as we finished breakfast, a telegram arrived from Lestrade himself. Come instantly, 131 Pitt Street, Kensington. With Holmes' usual energy, we did go, instantly. There, we found the railings outside the house all lined by a curious crowd.
By George, Watson, it must be attempted murder at the very least. There's nothing else will hold the interest of the London Messenger boy.
There's the street waiting for us, Holmes. Good morning, Inspector. Good
morning, gentlemen. Come in. Yes, Napoleon business again, Mr. Holmes.
Ah, I guessed as much. What is it this time, Lestrade?
Murder, sir.
Splendid. Do close the door, my dear Watson.
Yes.
This confounded crowd. This is Mr. Horace Harker, gentlemen, the owner of this house. Mr. Sherlock Holmes and Dr. Watson, Mr. Harker.
Good morning, sir.
How do you do?
Mr. Harker's a reporter for the Central Press Syndicate, Mr. Holmes.
I'd gathered so much already, Lestrade. Well, Mr. Harker, will you kindly tell us exactly what has happened?
Well, I'll do my best, sir. It all seems to center around a bust of Napoleon I bought for this very room about 4 months ago. Mm-hmm.
Where did you buy it, Mr. Harker?
What? Oh, Harding Brothers, you know, a few doors up from the High Street Station. I don't know what that's got to do with it. Anyway, most of my writing work's done at night, you know. Habit of mine. And I was sitting upstairs in my den about 3 o'clock this morning when I suddenly heard the most horrible yell from down here. Oh, the most dreadful sound, Mr. Holmes.
Plainly news on your own doorstep, Mr. Harker. As a reporter, I should have thought you would have welcomed such a diversion.
Oh, I couldn't. I was too unnerved. I don't mind telling you.
I see.
Anyway, I pulled myself together a bit and I got hold of a poker and came down and... When I got in here, the window was open, sir. And the first thing I saw was that the Napoleon bust had gone from the mantelpiece.
Intriguing. Most intriguing.
I'm sure my monomaniac theory is the only possible one, Holmes.
Yes, of course. And the murder, Mr. Harker?
Well, I rushed to the front door and threw it open and there, on the doorstep...
Well?
I nearly fell over... A dead man who was lying there.
Good gracious me.
Yes, he had a great gash in his throat and the whole place was swimming in blood.
But who was this murdered man? You've made inquiries, Lestrade.
Of course. There's nothing to show who he was. We've got the body in the mortuary. You can see it if you want.
What does he look like?
Tall, thin, sunburnt, poorly dressed. Artisan of some kind, I'd say. Obviously a foreigner. There wasn't any name on his clothing and there was nothing in his pockets except an apple and some string and a shilling map of London and a man's photograph. Here it is, Mr. Holmes.
Aha. Plainly not a picture of the fellow himself, judging by your description. What do you make of this, Watson?
Well, let's see. Mm-hmm. Well, somewhat simian in type, eh?
Yes.
Thick eyebrows, you see, Holmes. Very peculiar projection on the lower part of the face. Altogether, I should say, Southern European, I'd guess.
Admirable, Watson. And the bustless trade. What happened to Mr. Harker's bust of Napoleon?
We had news of it 5 minutes before you came. Smashed to smithereens in the front garden of an empty house in Camden Hill Road.
Aha. Uh-huh.
I'm going round to see it now. Want to come?
Well, of course. We leave you in peace now, Mr. Harker. I'm sure you must be impatient to write up your own story for one of your newspapers.
Oh, it's too late now, I'm afraid. The first editions are probably out with it already.
Oh, that's too bad.
Just my luck. Oh, but perhaps a cup of tea. I've been too confused to write a thing so far.
Well, at any rate, you must try. And you can quote me if you like. Say that I believe my friend Watson's theory is almost certainly the right one.
Ah, my dear Holmes, you really think...
Yes, he is convinced that the crime was the work of a dangerous homicidal lunatic with Napoleonic delusions.
Oh, thank you, Mr. Holmes. Yes, I could certainly use that.
you really do believe it, Holmes.
Why not, Watson? Why not? It'll serve for the moment and for the press. Come, Lestrade, let us view the remains.
Ah, yes, the body, Mr. Holmes.
No, the bust. I propose to indulge in a little jigsaw work. You see, if all the fragments fit together to make the head complete again...
What then, Holmes?
Well, I may be able to... Well, you and I will have some interesting work to do, Watson. Good morning, Mr. Harker.
Come, gentlemen.
With some little trouble, Holmes succeeded in reconstructing the whole bust from the splinters scattered over the garden of that empty house. Why he did this, I didn't know. Lestrade and I obediently, but mystified, fetched and carried at his direction. Holmes' face was enigmatic as he and I next drove to the premises of Morse Hudson, the supplier of the first three busts that had been broken. From him, we learnt the name of the original manufacturers of the articles, Messrs. Gelder and Company of Stepney. In rapid succession, we drove through the fringe of fashionable London, theatrical London, literary London, commercial London, and finally, maritime London, where the tenement houses swelter and reek with the outcasts of Europe. There, in a side street, we found the statuette factory, and we learnt from the proprietor.
Oh, but there are thousands, Mr. Holmes. We took thousands of casts of the Divine Napoleon.
I've no doubt it's a noble work. But this batch of six, noted down in these books of yours, which I have before me, you see the entries, Watson, all dated about a year ago.
Yes, and marked in two consignments. Yes, one set of three to Morse Hudson.
And the other three to Harding Brothers of Kensington. Ah. Who does the casting work on these statuettes of yours, Mr. Gelder?
Usually Italians, Mr. Holmes. We find they work well.
And you recognize this particular Italian, this obvious Italian? Watson, pray show him the photograph that Lestrade gave us.
Yes. Here it is.
Ah, the rascal. Beppo.
Beppo, indeed. Well, what was his other name?
I never knew it, even though he used to work here. Oh, he was a madman, sir. I never knew a man with such a temper. He knifed another Italian in the street one day. And then he came running into the works with the police on his heels, and they arrested him in this very workroom.
Well, and what sentence did he get?
The man he attacked lived, and so he got off with a year.
Uh-huh.
I must be out by now, of course. If you wanted to know where he is, we have a cousin of his here who could tell you.
No, not a word to the cousin, I beg of you.
No?
The matter's most important, Mr. Gelder. Indeed, the further I go with it, the more important it seems to grow. Watson, my dear fellow, where have you got to? Are you ready?
Yes, I'm here, Holmes. I was just...
Well, come along. There's no time to lose. I don't think we need intrude upon you then anymore, Mr. Gelder. I'm much obliged to you.
Oh, not at all. Only too glad to help you.
We have one more visit to make, Watson. To Harding Brothers back in Kensington. Then luncheon, I suggest. And a telegram to Lestrade to come to Baker Street this evening... And then, Watson...
And then, Holmes?
Yeah, well, that invaluable army revolver of yours may once more be pressed into service, old friend.
Indeed?
We have some dangerous work ahead of us, if I'm not mistaken. There are two of them still at large.
Two criminals, Holmes?
No, only one criminal. But two busts of Napoleon, my dear Watson. Come along!
And so, as always, I had to be content. Sherlock Holmes was at his most mysterious, and I knew so well how dearly he loved a mystery and would tell me nothing of his conclusions until his own time was ripe. I waited as best I could. Yet, as the slow, late summer day wore on, I felt a constantly rising excitement within me, and I saw that Holmes, too, was febrile and impatient, until at last... in response to our telegram, the good Lestrade appeared.
Ah, Lestrade, my dear Lestrade. You weren't busy, I hope.
Busy, Mr. Holmes? I'm always busy. It's our motto at the Yard.
Of course.
You'll be happy to hear, by the way, that I've solved our mystery.
What? You have?
Of course. We have our methods, too, you know. I've identified the dead man.
My dear Lestrade.
Oh, yes, Doctor. We've an inspector who makes a speciality of Saffron Hill and the Italian Quarter. And he knew our corpse the minute he set eyes on him. His name was Pietro Venucci. From Naples, he was. And he was one of the most notorious cutthroats in London.
Venucci, the last link.
He was connected with the old secret society of the Mafia, you see. And it's perfectly clear that he must have broken the rules in some way, so this fellow of the photograph is sent to kill him. Or even perhaps the other way around. You know how fiendish they are in these vendetta things. At any rate, one is shadowing the other. There's a scuffle outside Harker's house. And in the struggle, Venucci gets his death wound. How's that, Mr. Holmes?
Perfect, perfect.
I confess it seems to hang together admirably.
Yeah, except, of course, for Napoleon.
Ah, the busts are only a coincidence. We're on the murderer's trail, of course, as I expect you are too from your war. So all we need to do is to make our way to the Italian Quarter, where I've no doubt we'll be able to find him.
No, 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 my dear fellow, Chiswick.
Chiswick's a highly respectable residential district.
Ah, and therefore the most likely neighbourhood for spectacular happenings. If you've ever trusted me before, my dear Lestrade, trust me now. I'll promise to go with you tomorrow to the Italian Quarter if I fail you. Now, for your part, come with Watson and me tonight to Chiswick. Is that a bargain?
Well, I take you on trust, Mr. Holmes.
You do very wisely. You'll have dinner with us first, Lestrade.
Oh, now that's very nice.
Have you ordered the four-wheeler, Watson?
For 11, to take us over to be on the other side of Hammersmith Bridge.
Good, good. And you have the address, of course, the one we got from the fellow at Harding Brothers.
Yes, yes. Laburnum Lodge, Laburnum Vale, Chiswick.
Admirable. You never fail me, Watson. Oh, would you pass me my hunting crop there, Lestrade?
Is it?
Yeah, thank you. The handle is weighted with lead, the most useful weapon, as I've proved before. Now, let us address ourselves to the important process of nutrition. It may be a long time before we eat again.
More repos, the Elms, the Neves. Ah, Laburnum Lodge. Well, Holmes, here we are.
Excellent. And with this particularly tall fence for our concealment.
They've gone to bed, it seems. Whole place is in darkness.
I sent Mr. Brown a personal message asking him to cooperate.
Mr. Brown? Mr. Josiah Brown, Lestrade, whose name we obtained as the purchaser of the fifth Napoleon.
You and your Napoleons, Mr. Holmes. I've told you that all that part of it's only coincidence. It's this Mafia business that's the real crux.
Well, well, if you say so, Lestrade. Now then, Watson, do you crouch down here, close to the hedge? You better lie down in the long grass, Watson, here. Yeah, and, Lestrade, you stay here beside me.
Yeah.
Good, good.
Look there, Mr. Holmes. The open window.
What? Not so long after all, then.
Yes, that's him. He must have been inside when we arrived. Our luck's in.
There's a light there, flickering. Do you see?
Yes, we've got him. And in respectable Chiswick, too, Lestrade.
He's climbing out. Oh, thank heaven for the moonlight.
Look, he's carrying something white under his arm.
Ah, the fifth Napoleon. No, wait, Lestrade. Wait, wait, man. Let's see what he does. He's coming closer, do you see?
He stopped there, by the street lamp. Holmes, I do believe he's going to...
Exactly. Smashed to smithereens like all the others. And while he's busy examining it, Lestrade...
On him! Watson! After me!
He's safe enough now, I reckon. What's your name, my man? Won't speak, eh?
His name's Beppo Lestrade. At least if I follow Holmes aright. Holmes, didn't you say that? Oh, good heavens, where is he? Holmes!
All right, Watson, I'm over here with the bust. Ah, well, Lestrade, you've got him then. For my own part, I've been attending to our friend the good Napoleon, but with no good results so far, I fear. It seems the final secret still eludes us.
Upon my soul, Mr. Holmes, you beat me. You do, really. Still harping on about these statues.
Yes, I'm almost one of Watson's monomaniacs on the subject, Lestrade.
Shall we send him any liberty?
Oh, will you please take the prisoner to Bow Street now, Lestrade? Sure. And if you'll kindly come round to Baker Street at about 6 o'clock tomorrow evening, I think I shall then be able to show you that even now you've not grasped the entire meaning of this affair. Come, Watson, come back to Baker Street in our four-wheeler. What time is it, Watson?
6 o'clock, Holmes. And here comes our man, dead on time.
Ah, Lestrade, good evening to you.
Good evening, good evening.
Well, Mr. Holmes, you were right, of course.
Of course, of course.
I mean about the fellow Beppo. I've been able to check everything. Other name unknown, pretty celebrated as a ne'er-do-well in the Italian colony, temper of the fiend. Used to be a successful sculptor, but fell in evil ways.
Watson, that's the street bell, I believe. Ah, yes, and I hear footsteps on the staircase. Would you prepare to receive our visitor?
Certainly, Holmes, certainly. Ah, good evening, sir. Mr. Sandiford of Reading, I suppose.
Yes, sir. Mr. Sherlock Holmes is expecting me. I had a letter from him by special messenger.
Yes, yes, come in, Mr. Sandiford. This is Mr. Holmes here.
Good evening, sir.
Let me take your bag.
Carefully, carefully, I beg you, my dear Watson. That bag contains the whole object of our search. That's right, isn't it, Mr. Sandiford?
Well, if you mean the Napoleon bust, yes, it does, sir. Yeah. It beats me how you knew I had one.
Well, we had your name from Mr. Harding of Harding Brothers, Mr. Sandiford. He told us that they'd sold you their last copy, and they gave us your address.
Yes, quite so. Now then, sir, do you agree to my terms as I set them out in my letter?
Well, you said you'd be prepared to pay me £10 for it.
£10 it is, Mr. Sandiford.
Oh, I'm an honest man, Mr. Holmes. Of course, the money attracts me, but... I think you ought to know I only paid 15 shillings for it.
I've named my price, Mr. Sandiford, and I intend to stick to it. There you are, sir. £10. Yes, and in return, I shall only ask you to sign this paper in the presence of these witnesses. It's simply to say that you transfer all possible rights you ever had in the purchase to me. Thank you so much. Good evening, Mr. Sandiford. The landlady downstairs will show you out.
Oh, I'm much obliged to you, I'm sure, Mr. Holmes. Good evening, gentlemen.
Good evening. Good evening.
Now, Watson, now, Lestrade, the bust on the table there, and my celebrated loaded hunting crop in my hand, and so!
Holmes!
Great heavens, sir!
Holmes, what are you doing?
Do you see? There, the perfect hiding place. That's what I was looking for when I fitted the other bust together in the garden. See, that fragment that was the Emperor's ear, embedded like a plum in a pudding? Let me introduce you, gentlemen, to the famous Black Pearl of the Borgias. Nothing less.
What? Well, bravo, Holmes. Bravo, sir.
Bless my soul. Bravo, bravo indeed.
Thank you, gentlemen. Thank you.
But what made you link it all together, Holmes?
Elementary, my dear Watson. You'll remember, Lestrade, that at the time when the pearl disappeared, some suspicion fell on the princess's maid, who was an Italian girl named...
Venucci. Of course.
Lucrezia Venucci. It was believed that she had a brother in London who worked with her as a jewel thief.
The fellow who was murdered 2 nights ago.
As you say, Watson. I then recollected that the pearl had disappeared just 2 days before the arrest of the man Beppo for some crime of violence.
Huh.
The police were after him. He had the pearl in his possession. He may have stolen it from Venucci, or he may even have been Venucci's confederate. At any event, before the police arrived, he hid it in the only place he could think of in the moment. One of the wet plaster casts of the Napoleon head, which were at that moment being molded in the factory.
And he's been in prison for a year.
Just so. And when he came out, he found from his cousin in the factory where that consignment of that day's Napoleons had gone. And somehow or other traced the address of each purchaser.
But how did he run across Venucci again?
Ah, we'll never know that, Lestrade, unless he decides to talk. I take it that they may have quarreled if they were confederates, or that Venucci was out for revenge if Beppo had stolen the gem from him. At any rate, he also got on the trail. They met outside Harker's house. There was a scuffle, and behold, your murder, Lestrade.
And you knew the pearl must be in the Sandiford bust, Holmes.
Well, naturally, when I saw last night that it wasn't in the fifth one at Liburnum Lodge.
Huh.
I wrote to Mr. Sandiford, as you know, bought the pearl in your presence from the owner for £10, and there it lies in all its glory.
Well, I've seen you handle a good many cases, Mr. Holmes, but I don't know that I ever knew a more workmanlike one than that. We're not jealous of you at the Scotland Yard. Oh, no, sir. We're very proud of you. And if you come down tomorrow, there's not a man, from the oldest inspector to the youngest constable, who wouldn't be glad to shake you by the hand.
Thank you, Lestrade. Thank you.
And as he played that evening, with Lestrade's tribute still ringing in his ears, it seemed to me, who knew him so well, that he was more nearly moved by the softer emotions than I'd ever seen him. So ended, then, the case of the six Napoleons in the year 1900, when I was back once more, after the death of my wife, in those old rooms in Baker Street, which I shared with the man I most revered in all the world, Mr. Sherlock Holmes.
The Adventures of Sherlock Holmes, based on the original stories of Sir Arthur Conan Doyle, have been dramatized anew with original music composed by Sidney Torch. Sir Ralph Richardson played the part of Dr. Watson, and Sir John Gielgud that of Sherlock Holmes. The program was produced by Harry Allen Towers.